2004, Absolute Radio, behind the park stage. Those dancing days, I think they've just about finished. Fantastic band, a cracking set of lasses. But look who's here.
Hello.
Hello, it's Robin Ince.
Who am I? Oh, good. That's good, because we're in the second day. Well, I'm the fifth day for some people. You know, yeah. The mud and the sun have combined to create a very difficult to work out what my personality is.
A vortex of knowledge.
Even if I have any self-consciousness left.
Because you're quite busy. You're doing about five different sets. I think you're going to be tidying up at the end as well.
There's a lot of work to be done. This morning I was doing a show called Infinite Monkey Cage that I do with Professor Brian Cox, yes. The man who looks up at the sky in wonder and delight. And so it was quite nice to actually start the day attempting to talk about quantum electrodynamics in a large tent. A huge audience. It was fantastic. We had Billy Bragg on as well, and Graham Coxon, and Chappie Coulsandy. And it was a great way to start the day. But just as you sat there and you look at these, 3,000 people, you go, I don't know if this is the right time to start talking about science. No. I mean, a lot of nice kind of, there was some, some booze, Billy was kind of going, sometimes you've got to look at these things and go, the science itself might be a religion, and way from some people, and then Brian going, no, it's not, there's a different way of looking at it, it's a logical, progression of a boo, so it was good. It became a very panto festival of science.
So it's kind of like a big sort of, are you like judges or something? Is it kind of like a panel or something?
No, it's just basically, there's me and Brian and then the guests. And today we were talking about can rationalism and mysticism meet? We thought, as we're going to be, so near a ley line, we would find that out. And I think in the end, we found a lot of common ground.
Is he not the enemy of sort of, is sort of Cox and yourself the enemy of a lot of the sort of slightly more esoteric sort of hippie sort of ideas that are kicking around the festival? Do you not just want to pile into the stone circle and just lay in a emotional and knowledge smackdown on them?
Well, do you know what I think?
If you've got
a nice little coping mechanism and it keeps you happy and it doesn't make other people's life awful, I don't really have a problem with it. I mean, I was saying on the show today, the fact is, quite often I'm an atheist and I see gatherings of atheists who are there knocking back a load of whiskey and having cigarettes and going, isn't it pathetic? These people need some kind of coping mechanism. And you go, well, I think we found a different one. But it's so, I mean, I think it's, I love Glastonbury and I really, the left field tent where I'm playing like today, there are obviously, there's a huge number of people. You couldn't say they're a particular type of person, but you do have lots of really passionate people here, politically passionate about whatever mysticism they may well like, but not in a kind of intrusive manner, and also rationalism. It's a real joy. Yeah. I mean, this is a triumph of rationalism, the fact that they've somehow made this enormous city in a field for a week.
And I imagine it's very different than the bare sort of pit that is the Comedy Store, I imagine. So it's very different.
I'm quite lucky because I really live in my own kind of other world. All I do is I do weird festivals, and I do my own shows and shows about science with Brian and Ben Golder. So I don't really experience that anymore. In fact, I will.
You don't have to do that
nervous
anymore. I guess back in the day, you'd sort
yeah.
Of
I mean, yeah. The early days, obviously, you find yourself standing in front of an audience that have no interest in you, and you trying to think, can I still be me and get away with this audience liking me? And sometimes you think, do you know what? I have to go down in flames rather than change my attitude to fit in with them.
But that's always how the best comedy is, or certainly the most respected comic sort of work.
I think
possibly
most
not the most
of
financially
acts
rewarded.
Well, I don't know. You see, I think there's a huge gap now between you've got the mainstream, which is people like Michael McIntyre. I have nothing against Michael. It doesn't matter. Very clear. I think what he does and for the audience he plays for, he's really excellent.
It's a completely
at that.
Different thing.
It's a different thing. And then you've got the kind of the alternative side, which is Josie Long and Stuart Lee and all of those people. And there's a wide number of people, lots of different ages. Norman Lovett fits into that. And he's someone who was there in the early days of alternative comedy. I think it's fantastic. You've got a mainstream and now you've got an alternative. I don't think the O2 will ever necessarily want me standing there doing some kind of routine about the existentialism of Ingmar Bergman, even though I think the punchline's effective, but it does require seeing at least two of his films.
Which I imagine a lot of the people at the O2 probably didn't.
They don't put the effort in. They don't put the effort in when it comes to Swedish existentialism.
They should put a couple of films, maybe get a boat on down the Thames towards Greenwich, and then sort of put a couple of films on while they're on the boat, I guess. Maybe.
That is the kind of pub I want to see. See these pubs which say, sports coverage every day? Why don't we see more pubs saying, Ingmar Bergman, every Tuesday, 2:00, I sit there, have a nice pint, and then wonder why I exist.
Like a nice, or a nice arts film, like Noi Albanoi or something like that, a lovely bit of Icelandic theatre, cinema. You're doing Edinburgh again, no doubt.
Yes.
The busiest man in...
I'm doing four shows in Edinburgh. I'm doing a group show about science at lunchtime. Then in the afternoon I'm doing a show with my mate Michael Legg called Pointless Anger, Righteous Ire 2, Back in the Habit.
That is two furious men together at last, isn't it?
Oh, we're going to be very, very angry. Last year I think there were a couple of shows where we thought we'd probably die. And then I'm doing one show about Can You Be Happy Through Science called, what's it called? Oh yeah, Star Corps Apple Child.
Okay.
I may well explain what that means in the show, or I may remain enigmatic. And then I'm going to do one called Robin Itz's Struggle for Existence, which is everything I couldn't fit into the other shows.
Okie dokie. Are you going to be
it's a kind of bin, basically, the last show.
Are you going to be sort of doing your podcast with Josie up there? Or sort of?
Yes, Josie Long and me will be doing more Utter Shambles as well. In fact, Billy Bragg's going to do one for us.
You've had some incredible guests. Alan Moore, you got the pleasure of that
Moore's
one.
Oh, Alan Moore's great. I mean, Alan, I got him to do Cheltenham Science Festival the other week. And you know what? Sitting having breakfast with Alan Moore, at one point he was reciting Viz's parody of Brian Cox, you know, coming from Alan Moore's mouth made it so much more poetic. Not that it wasn't poetic already. And also then you're just sitting there going, you know, for this man that some people think is a shaman stroke wizard, his understanding of cosmology is quite remarkable.
Okay.
And so yeah, it's an absolute, I mean, that's the joy of it. We, you know, all the things I do, pretty much I'm working with people that I love working with, excited to find out what they think. And I am, you know, at this point, because I'm feeling happy, I'll say I'm an extremely lucky person.
Yeah.
Catch me at another time, I'll be very, very angry, punching a fence.
Possibly 11 o'clock in the evening when you've had quite enough of comedy. And speaking of comedy, you've obviously been in it for quite a while, you know pretty much everyone on the circuit. Jim Tavoret, the cello comic, he's had his identity stolen. I was fascinated to read this week.
This was intriguing, yeah, because when he first tweeted it, this Sid Bofin, I think the guy's called, I thought it was the start of some kind of elaborate joke and set up for an Edinburgh show in which, a bit like a comic called Nick Wilty once did a whole show as a Nick Wilty impersonator.
Right, okay.
And I thought maybe that's what it is. But yeah, it does seem the similarities. I probably haven't seen enough.
I think the guy's pulled his YouTube videos down as well, so it's kind of hard for him to back it up.
Yeah, I think it's a bit... What I saw, I thought there's definitely a similarity.
Yeah.
I guess
one man with a violin and one man with an instrument is very similar. I guess.
And if you've got exactly the same garb and the same lack of hairstyle,
yeah,
then.
I guess so, yeah.
But yeah, I mean, there's so, you know, so much this goes on.
Yeah.
I hope Jim sorts it out.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much.
I wish them both the best of luck. No, I don't know. I don't know
don't
one
care.
Of them. I can't,
it's every man for himself.
Yeah, exactly.
My word. Robin Ince, it's been an absolute pleasure. Good luck with the rest of the festival and indeed Edinburgh.
Thank you very much.